Hello. You guys good? Good. Hey, it's been like 4 weeks since I've seen you. I missed you a lot. Did you miss me? It's fine. Just don't tell me if you didn't, please. Don't hurt my feelings. Hey, I want you to do this really quick. I want you to turn and look around this room really quick at all the people, okay? Look at the people next to you, around you, behind you, in front of you. Don't be weird and creepy about it. Just observe. Okay, I want you to observe how you are different or similar to the people around you, okay? So look at your hair color, the type of hair that you have, your eye color. Compare your shoe size to the people next to you. Are yours bigger or smaller? Okay, look at did you guys put your fingerprints on your outline? Okay, compare your fingerprints to the people next to you. How are they different? Right? Okay, so, yeah, everybody good? Again, don't be weird. Don't be creepy. Just look. Okay, raise your hand if you are if you see an exact identical clone of yourself in this room, like somebody who is exactly the same as you. Anybody? All right, that's a good thing. That's a good thing. No, of course not. There's no two people in this room that are identical in every way. In fact, I don't know if you knew this, there has never been a human being in the history of humanity or who will ever exist that is the exact same as anybody else. Even identical twins, did you know that they share the same DNA? That's crazy about identical twins. But even identical twins have things that are different. Their fingerprints are different, right? They might have different freckles or weird birthmarks on their face or something like that. But that's just on the outside, too. If you go on the inside of people, there's so much about us on the inside that makes us different. So, like, our personalities. Is anybody an introvert and extrovert? Do you know the difference between those? Like, extrovert, you get, like, energized by being around people all the time. But introverts, you, like, need your alone time. Who thinks that they're an extrovert? Who thinks that they're an introvert? Yeah, my hand's up for that one. Yeah, I need my alone time every once in a while. I love people, but personalities are different. Our strengths and weaknesses are different. Our likes and dislikes. There's all kinds of stuff on the inside and the out that makes people unique. In fact, that's what we're talking about today is I was made unique. Write that down. That's the first blank on the top of your outline. I was made unique because every single human that has ever existed or who will ever exist is unique from everybody else. There's all kinds of things that make us unique. Now, we were made. That blank said, I was made unique. The key word in that is made because you aren't just an accident, right? You didn't just happen. You were made by God. There's a lot of really smart people, a lot of scientists, people like that. They're really brilliant, but they would want you to believe that you are an accident, that you just kind of happened. You are a phenomena of the universe, that you are just like a product of a couple atoms colliding together randomly and then evolving over billions and billions and billions of years until you somehow became these complex bodies that you now have. That's what a lot of really smart people believe, that you're just kind of an accident. I actually believe that that takes a lot more faith to believe that you're just an accident than it is to believe that you were made by somebody. And the truth is, the Bible tells us that we were made, we were created by God. There's this really beautiful verse in Isaiah chapter 64, Old Testament, gives us a picture of how God made each one of us. Check this out. It says, "And yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are the potter. We are all formed by your hands." I love the picture of that. You can almost like close your eyes and imagine God as this potter shaping us, forming us, molding us by hand. Has anybody ever made anything out of clay before, like an art class or something like that? Or maybe Play-Doh, that counts too, I guess. Yeah, it's a little bit harder than it looks, right, to make something out of clay. And has anybody ever made like a clay pot on a wheel, like a throwing wheel? Yeah, that's kind of hard, right? It takes some skill to make a clay pot. But let's imagine for a second. Let's imagine that you are a master potter, okay? And then let's imagine you spend all day making 100 clay pots. Like the same, you want to make the same kind of clay pot. It takes you all day long. Now, at the end of that day, you make 100 of those. Are all 100 of those clay pots going to be completely identical? No way. Not a chance. Right, they're all going to be a little bit different. They're probably, hopefully, going to be like roughly clay pot shaped if you're good enough. But Some are going to be a little bit bigger or wider than others. Some are going to be more symmetrical than others. Some are going to have weird lumps on the side of them probably. Some of them are going to get like cracks and explode when you try to fire them in the kiln later. Right? They're all going to be a little bit different. And that verse says that God made us like a potter makes something out of clay. And when he made all of us, he hand-formed every single one of us, we all turned out a little bit different. We're not identical. We're not exactly the same. We're all humans, but there's all kinds of little differences about us. And here's the thing. Some people would want you to believe, or some people think, that being unique is wrong, or that you shouldn't want to be unique. You shouldn't want to stand out or be different. That it's actually better to just blend in and be like everybody else, to look like the people around you, to act like the people around you, to behave and think and talk like the people around you. Maybe you've even had that same thought that, like, I don't know if I want to be unique. I don't know if I want to stand out or be different, because that's kind of intimidating. I just kind of want to blend in. I just want to be like the people around me. I just want to be ordinary. The truth is, guys, there's no such thing as ordinary, because nobody is the same. No one is the same. Everybody's different. We're all unique. And actually, there's a lot of value in uniqueness. Does anybody into Pokemon here? It's okay. Safe place. You can be into Pokemon here. Yeah. I was into Pokemon when I was younger, but Pokemon, I don't know if you knew this, there is a huge market out there, mainly in like places like Japan, but actually in the United States too. There's a huge market for buying and selling Pokemon cards. Did you know this? Okay, so the cards that are like, you can play games with them or you can trade them. Most people do that, trade or collect them. There is a massive market for buying and selling Pokemon cards. Actually, one of my really good friends is one of the top U.S. sellers on eBay for Pokemon cards. Like, true story. He's made, like, so much money selling Pokemon cards. He won't tell me how much money he's made, because I think he's a little embarrassed about it, but it's a lot. Like, we're talking thousands of dollars that he's made selling Pokemon cards. Isn't that nuts? So I was doing a little bit of research this week on, like, the most valuable Pokemon cards out there, because the truth is, not all Pokemon cards have a ton of value, because a lot of them are really common, or maybe they're not in great shape. So those ones, you can't sell those for really much money at all. But there are some cards that are way more rare, and those are worth a little bit more money. And then there are some that are considered ultra rare. And there's a few of these in the ultra rare category that sell for like mind-blowing amounts of money. Okay, so I have a picture. This is the most rare card out there. I think it's called Raichu. Anybody? Yeah. Okay. So this specific kind is like a first edition, tournament edition, something. I can't remember all the things about it. This card, there's only believed to be 8 of them in existence. And in fact, it's so rare, ultra rare, it's so valuable that they don't actually know how much this card is worth, because it's never been sold before. So its value is unknown. It's like literally priceless. But just to kind of put it in perspective a little bit, the next most rare card behind this one has sold for over $200,000. Isn't that crazy? $200,000. It's literally a piece of paper that's been printed on. But because it is so rare, because it's so unique, its value is literally priceless. Isn't that crazy? I'm going to say something you probably nobody's ever said to you before. You are like an ultra-rare Pokemon card to God. And nobody's ever said that to you, probably. You are like an ultra-rare Pokemon card to God. Seriously, because there's only one of you. You are one of a kind. That Raichu card, there's 8 of them. And that's even priceless. But you, there's only one of you. You are incredibly valuable to God because there's only one of you. You're unique. Your value is literally priceless to God. You're priceless. Uniqueness has value. And in fact, I want to get you a little bit personal for you a little bit, okay? So on your outline, there's a box, and above it says, I am unique. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to spend like 30 seconds inside that box, write down some of the things about you that make you unique from everybody else around you. Okay, so write down some of the unique things about you, facts about you, right? Some attributes of yourself. I'm going to read some of the ones I wrote in my box just to kind of give you some ideas while you're writing in your box. So here's some unique things about me. I love traveling to new places. I hate peanut butter. I love scary movies. I drink my hot coffee black, but I put vanilla and half in my iced coffee. My left ear is always cold. My right ear is always hot. I don't know why. I can see both the big picture of things and the small details at the same time. I think baseball is really boring, but I like watching golf on TV. I prefer fruity desserts to chocolate desserts. My favorite food is chips and salsa. I have a soft spot for the underdog. I love people, but I also love my alone time. I'm an introvert there. And I love sports, but I really hate to run. So those are some of the unique things about Matt. But what are you writing in your box? What are some of the unique things about you? There's tons, right? There's tons of things that make you unique. But some of the things that make us unique are actually things that other people would consider wrong about us. Some of the things that are flaws or imperfections about us. Those are some of the things that make us the most unique. But here's the thing. We all have flaws. That's not a secret. There's all kinds of stuff about us that is broken and imperfect. You can think of immediately probably some of the things that are imperfect about you. But I want you to hear me say this. That's not the way it was supposed to be. When God first made humans, when he first made people, us, he didn't create us with flaws and imperfections. He actually created us to be perfect, right? If you know the story, the first humans, Adam and Eve, they were perfect. But if you also know the story, you know that they chose to disobey God. And when they did that, they chose their own way. They introduced sin into the world. And sin is just any time that we choose our way over God's way. And what sin did is it took all the perfection of God's creation, including you and me, and it made them imperfect. It brought imperfections into the mix. And so now, as humans, we have things like diseases and deformities and defects. Our world is full of division. There's death. All those things weren't part of the original plan, but they are byproducts and results of sin. And so some of the things that make us the most unique are actually our flaws. But here's one of the most incredible things about our God, guys, is God has the ability to redeem things. And what that means is he has the ability to take even the most broken and messed up and imperfect and flawed things about us, and he can use those things and make them some of the most beautiful and most usable things about us. Even our flaws can be used by God. How many of you guys have ever read the book or seen the movie Wonder before? Yeah, a lot of us. Phenomenal story. If you haven't read it, I would highly recommend it. It's a book. It's also a really great movie. But this is a story, if you don't know, of a 10-year-old kid named Augie who was born with really severe facial deformities. And this story kind of follows him as he navigates public school for the first time, fifth grade. It's a really, really great story. But actually, the ending scene of this movie, I think, gives us a really great picture of this, what we're talking about. And so I want you to check this out.
Ladies, gentlemen, boys and girls, graduates, final award this morning is the Henry Ward Beecher Medal to honor students who have been notable or exemplary, usually. It's a good works, a service award. But I came upon a passage that he wrote, which made me realize that good works come in many forms. Greatness, he wrote, lies not in being strong, but in the right using of strength. He or she is the greatest whose strength carries up the most hearts by the attraction of his own. Without further ado, this year, I am very proud to award the Henry Ward Beecher Medal to the student whose quiet strength has carried up the most hearts. So, will August Pullman please come up here to receive this award?
Walking up towards that stage, I felt like I was floating. My heart was beating so fast. I didn't really understand why I was getting a medal. It's not like I blew up the Death Star. All I did was get through fifth grade, just like everyone else here.
Congratulations. There you go. That's for you.
Then again, maybe that's kind of the point. Maybe the truth is, I'm really not so ordinary. Maybe if we knew what other people were thinking, we'd know that no one's ordinary. And we all deserve a standing ovation at least once in our lives. My friends do. My teachers do. My sister does for always being there for me. My dad does for always making us laugh. And my mom does the most for never giving up on anything, especially me. It's like that last precept Mr. Brown gave us. Be kind, for everyone is fighting a hard battle. And if you really want to see what people are, all you have to do is look.
Don't you just love that? I love what Augie says at the end of that. He says, no one is ordinary. Isn't that true? None of us are ordinary. We're weird. We're different. We're unique. We're imperfect. We're flawed. But Augie learned that even his flaws, his were really visible. We all have flaws. Even our flaws have purpose. That's the next thing I want you to write down in your outline is even my flaws can have purpose. When we involve Jesus in this process, guys, this truth becomes like times a billion. Jesus can use our flaws even in some really good ways, in some really huge and powerful ways. One of the best promises, I think, that we get about God in the Bible and Scripture comes out of the book of Romans 8:28. It's coming up on the screen. Here's what it says. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose for them. Can you underline the word everything there on that, on your outline? God causes everything. That means the good stuff in our life and the bad stuff. The good things about us and the flawed things about us. God can use all of those, everything, to work together for our good, if we love him, if we trust him. He promises us that. That's an amazing promise. And that promise is not just about us. It's not like he will just use those things for good in our lives. He will use them also to help other people, because that's just what he does. So even our flaws can be used for good, not just for us, but for the sake of others. The last thing I want you to write down today is on your outline is this. God can use my uniqueness to do anything. Write that down. God can use my uniqueness to do anything. I know that kind of sounds a little cute and cliche maybe, that God can use my uniqueness to do anything. But guys, this is truth. This is just straight up true. And this truth actually has nothing to do with who we are and everything to do with who's in us. Let me explain that, because if you are a Christian in this room right now, if you consider yourself a Christian, you walked across that line and put your faith and your trust in Jesus, something really amazing happened that moment. I don't know if you know this, but in that moment, your body stopped becoming just yours, but you actually are sharing your body with somebody else. You're sharing it with God, His Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is living inside of us. The Bible tells us that. It makes it really, really clear. And I want to give you a little bit of an idea, if you don't know, how amazing that is. Because in the Old Testament, so before Jesus, in order to access God's Spirit, you had to go to a place. It was called the temple, right? God's the Jewish people, the Israelites, they built this temple as a house for God's Spirit to live. And they had to go to that place in order to access God's Holy Spirit. But now, after Jesus, the Holy Spirit was released and unleashed onto people. So now we are the dwelling place. We are the house for God's Spirit. And so when you think about it in terms of that truth, that God can use my uniqueness to do anything, it's not because of us. We're not anything special. It's because of who's inside of us. And God can do anything. We know that to be true. And He can work in and through us then to do anything. I kind of want to close today by reading this last verse and out of the book of Ephesians. But I want to kind of read it over you as a little bit of a blessing. Okay, so here's what I want you to do. I want you to close your eyes. And I want you to kind of soak in these words as I say them, okay? As I read these words over you. So close your eyes. Now all glory to God, who is able, through His mighty power at work within us, to accomplish infinitely more than we might ask or think. Glory to Him in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. You can open your eyes. You are unique. You are an ultra-rare Pokemon card. And God wants to use your uniqueness to do infinitely more than you could ever imagine, if you trust Him. Your thought for the week that I want you to leave you with is this. God can use me. Write that down. God can use me. He can. And He wants to. Let's pray. God, I thank You that You didn't just make cookie cutter humans, that we're not all identical, we're not the same, but that we're unique. That there's all sorts of stuff that makes us different and weird and different and unique. Even our imperfections, even our flaws, You can use those to do whatever You want. You can do anything. So God, I ask You to help us trust You in those moments, especially with our flaws, because I think a lot of times those can be hard for us. We don't like them. We wish You didn't have them most of the time. But God, even our flaws can be used and have purpose. And so help us to trust You in those with those things and say, God, I don't know how You want to use this. I don't know how You can use this. But I trust that You can and You want to. So God, would you use us in our uniqueness to do infinitely more than we could ever ask or imagine? We pray this in Your name, Jesus. Amen.